Apple has added some powerful new tools along with updating some old ones that are really gonna help you build apps faster and easier. It doesn't matter if you're a junior developer or a senior one, every developer has access to these tools. So let's get started and find out things iOS developer has stopped doing. And if you want to learn from a senior iOS developer, go ahead and check out rebeloper.com/mentoring, where you can meet me on a 60-minute Zoom call where I can teach you about Swift, Swift UI, or maybe I can debug your code or whatever you'd like to talk about. I'm available. It's at rebeloper.com/mentoring. Now, today we are going to talk about what did iOS developers stop doing. So for that, go ahead and check out the link in the description where you will find all the resources for my YouTube videos, and then you will find there doc archive, and all you have to do is just double click on it, and then Xcode's developer border will just open up, and this is what you will see. Let's just close this, and let's talk about the 10 things iOS developers have stopped doing. Now, of course, iOS development is continuously changing, and let's take a look at these things that we have stopped developing. And I have added this into three chapters: Apple tools, third-party tools, and writing code. So go ahead and check them out. What I will do is just go through all of them one by one. So let's start with storyboards. Now, if you know how to code the user interface, then it's much better, because then you know the underlying code, the underlying functionality. And that doesn't really happen necessarily with storyboard. You kind of visually know what's going on, but not really know what's going on. Let's take a look at the pros and cons of using storyboards inside your application. Now, a pro, and there are two here, and basically they are kind of pro, but yeah, I do have my doubts with it. And of course, you can just choose this over some other ways like Swift UI, but go ahead and check that out. First one is the performance, but code is also performance. So basically, storyboards are performant. They are not loaded all in into memory. They are lazily loaded, so-called. But code is also performant. So basically, you should just use code. They're also great for prototyping. So if you want to build your application in UIKit, then storyboard is the way to go if you want to create a quick and dirty prototype. Of course, there's also Swift UI, which is not UIKit, definitely. And Swift UI is much better and faster in prototyping, of course. And also you get the code part that you learn how things work. So yeah, if you want to have prototypes, storyboard is the way to go if you are only in UIKit. Now, there are a lot of cons. So, reusability. So, actually, you can't really reuse storyboards. You have to always bind and add variables there. Difficulty to maintain. Now, because you are always connecting these storyboards to the code, if you change some connection or just break a connection, then you will have a tough time debugging that. Hard to navigate. If you know storyboards, then you will see that it's always hard to navigate between those view controllers. It's always like you cannot decouple your navigation. So yeah, it's hard to navigate. Data flow. So data is really going to flow inside your code. So it's not like data is flowing in storyboards. So basically, you have to kind of connect your code with storyboards. Merge conflicts. So yeah, merge conflicts with storyboards are a nightmare. Reusability in terms of, okay, oh, I added reusability twice, but yeah, it really makes a point. You do need to worry about reusability. Code can do more because, yeah, storyboards is kind of limited. It's okay, but code can do much, much more. And of course, Swift UI does a better job. I'm always keen on starting a Swift UI app rather than a UIKit slash storyboard application. Now, you might be wondering, how could I remove a storyboard if I already have it? Because if you start off a UIKit application, then you will have that main.storyboard inside your application. So let's take a look at that. First of all, you want to right click on your main storyboard, select delete, and after you delete it, you actually want to select move to trash, not just removing the reference, because that will still leave that file inside your project. And then you want to remove the main interface. Now that is found under targets, general, and under deployment info. As you can see, you just want to delete main, actually the name of the main.storyboard, the main interface, and just leave it as empty. Next up, you want to remove all traces, and this is kind of the last step where you want to delete, is delete the storyboard name, but the key value pair. So not just delete main like you did previously in the main interface, you want to remove that key value pair by clicking on that minus button. After that, the storyboard will not be available, so Xcode, this project, will not know where to find the starting view controller. So what you want to do is add that inside code. So you want to open up your scene delegate file. It will look something like this, and then create a Windows scene, and on that create a window from that Windows scene. On that Windows root view controller, just add root your view controller. Set the window to the self.window and make key and visible. By the way, you will be able to just copy and paste this into your project once you download this resource. And that is why I really never use storyboards, and I believe that iOS developers already stopped using this a while ago. Next up is StoreKit 1. So why did developers stop using StoreKit 1? Well, basically because there is a StoreKit 2, and it's way, way better. Now, working with in-app purchases in StoreKit 2 is way better than in StoreKit 1. But there are some pros and cons, and the obvious pro of StoreKit 1 is that you can use it in pre-iOS 15 / macOS 12. So if your app is running pre-iOS 15 or macOS 12, then you really need to use StoreKit 1. If not, then here are the cons. So basically, StoreKit 1, and that is, it's you have to set up an on-device validation or a server validation, which is really, really tedious. You have to use this C-based OpenCSL library to decrypt all of that crazy stuff. Now, StoreKit 2 already handles this. And also, StoreKit 1 is a delegate-based methods. They have these delegate-based methods, but StoreKit 2 fully embraces async await, which I definitely like. Now, being that said, in-app purchases are really, really hard to implement, even with StoreKit 2. So what's my suggestion on that? Well, you should take a look at my video on the YouTube channel about in-app purchases finally made easy. Take a look at that. It's a free YouTube video right over here. And what I'm using there is StoreKit Pro. And go ahead and check out StoreKit Pro. It's at store.rebeloper.com/StoreKit Pro, and just take a look at all the advantages that this has. By the way, it's also working for Swift UI and UIKit. Recently, I added UIKit support, so go ahead and check that out. Now, let's continue and let's take a look at the social login. So this is something that iOS developers have stopped using, and basically because signing with Apple is just really, really convenient. So we might as well just use signing with Apple. So let's take a look at some pros and cons. If you're using social login, Apple actually requires you to add a sign-in with Apple button. So for example, if you have a sign-in with Facebook, or maybe sign in with Google, you do have to have a sign in with Apple button also. Now, this doesn't mean that you are required to use sign in with Apple, only in these cases. Two of the cases that you are not required to use sign in with Apple is whether you are using a sign in with email and password or anonymous sign in. So yeah, just use sign in with Apple. It's really, really straightforward, easy to use, easy for the user, If, of course, you already are not using something like Core Data or iCloud, where actually you don't really need to sign in your user. Okay, ads. Ads are no longer cool in apps. So should you use ads in your app? Well, actually not really, because there are a ton of other ways to monetize your apps, and users are kind of fed up with ads and kind of getting used to these new ways of monetization. And one of those is paid apps. Of course, the paid apps have been here for quite a while. And then you should consider adding subscriptions or in-app purchases, like non-consumable or consumable in-app purchases. Again, take a look at StoreKit Pro, how you can easily add that into your app. Now, RXSWIFT combined does it all for us, so that's why it's really kind of obsolete, because Apple's combined framework actually does it all for us. Is it relevant? Not really, because combined actually does provide us a declarative Swift API for processing values over time, and there are a lot of ways to, like, flat map, reduce, merge, map, which are really okay inside RxSwift. They have been there, and basically that's it. Combined kind of replaced RxSwift. Now, next up on the list that developers are not actually using anymore is for loops. Well, actually not for loops, but how we write for loops. And let's take a look at how we are actually writing for loops. Here's an example of how you would write a for loop. So you just go with for I in 0 till data.count. And you just go through all of the data, and you would just access the name from that data at the index of y. Now, there are a lot of ways of doing this, but there's an easier way right over here. So just use the for each loop. Just go for data.forEach, and then you get the name in and just print out the name. It's as simple as that. It's really, really straightforward, but I've seen many developers just sticking with the older version. But yeah, you should just drop that. Most probably, in some rare cases, you do want to use that, but this is the way to move forward. Now, another one thing that iOS developers stopped using is completion handlers, because async await has arrived. It's really, really cool, declarative, easy to understand, easy to write and read. So let's take a look at some code examples right over here. So let's say that we actually want to have this fetch request. We are fetching the name. We want to wait for the name to be fetched, and then we want to fetch the age of the person. Again, we want to wait for that. Maybe some error happened. And then we want to fetch its favorite framework. And with completion handlers, let's just take a look at some of these completion handlers, how they would work. And basically, we are creating an escaping result with a string or an int and an error. And this is how you would just get it. And as you can see, here is the pyramid of doom. We don't really like that. And at the end, we are just printing out the name, age, and favorite framework. Otherwise, we do really need to handle all of these errors. We just want to, well, currently I'm just printing it out, but of course you want to handle that. Maybe put them inside an alert. Now let's take a look how async await make this really, really simple to write and also to read. So there we go. Now here are the new fetch name, fetch age, and a fetch favorite framework functions, and they are asynchronous and throwing. So yeah, you can just uncomment these. That maybe they are just throwing something. Basically, we are just fetching some data from the servers, and all we have to do is just put them in an asynchronous context. That means that we are adding them inside the task, and handle a do catch statement right over here, and do a try await one after the other. As you can see, there are just one line of code after the other. We don't have that pyramid of doom. And after that, we are just going to print out the name, age, and favorite framework. Of course, my favorite framework is Swift UI. Okay, now, another thing that iOS developers stopped using is return. Now, in rare cases, of course, But let's take a look at those rare cases, and maybe you will also learn some new things. So if it's a one-liner, you don't have to specify return. So let's take a look at what I actually mean by that. So here is a simple function, do some work. It's going to return a string, and you would just return that string, of course. Now, there's an easier way of doing this, because we know that we are returning only one thing. Then you just simply can omit that. So you're just not going to type out a return. Now, of course, this is plain forward, but here's an example in Swift UI. So if you are creating a content view, this is what you are going to create. Now, you are not seeing any return right over here, but this computed property of the body needs to return something, and that is some sort of view, and is going to return that. Now, this is how it is written. Of course, this is also a good way of writing it, but it is unnecessary. And of course, it's cluttering our code. You don't really need to do this. All you have to do is just type out text, hello world, or a VStack or whatever. Okay, let's just move forward and let's see what else did we stop doing, and that is stop using singletons. So let's take a look at singletons, and basically there are why should we use and not use singletons, and the answer is just one, and that is because they are universally available. So we should use singletons because they are universally available. And we should not use singletons because they are universally available. And basically, this is how we would just create a singleton. This is a singleton when we are creating a class. We would just create a shared value of that singleton and do some work. And there's also another way of doing this with a struct. We are just creating a static function, static variables, and then we just go singleton and dot do some work. In another class, in a working class, pun intended. Okay, and finally, we have if statements, and we should better use guards. So let's take a look at why you should not really use if else statements, and basically nesting if else statements. That is our problem here. Let's take a look at this. So basically, I have a function right over here. Are we allowed to drink? We take a look at if less person equals person. So we unwrap that. And if the person's age is less than 18, then okay, we say not allowed to drink. If the person is less than 21, not allowed to drink in the US. Otherwise, we are allowed to drink. And of course, if the person does not exist, then not a person. So as you can see, there's quite a cumbersome. And again, we are kind of looking at some pyramid. And let's take a look at how we should use that with a guard. So we just go through guard let statements, guard statements, and all of that. Now, you can take a look at this in more depth in the next video that I would like you to see. And that is why nesting if-else statements is bad, and what you should do there instead. Go ahead and check it out. It's right over here.